Members, good morning. It's time to start the meeting. This is the Subcommittee to follow up issues relating to the three-runway system at the Hong Kong International Airport. According to the agenda, item one is to confirm the minutes of meeting held on the 7th of February 2017. The minutes have been issued to members. That's in paper CB bracket 4771. Stroke 16 to 17. The clerk has not received any proposals or amendments until now. Can members please confirm the minutes? Thank you. Item 2, meeting with the administration and the airport authority, Hong Kong. I'd like to say here that on the 7th of April, Mr. Eddie Chu issued a letter to the subcommittee requiring the administration and the airport authority respond to questions on the use of marine sand for reclamation or otherwise at the subcommittee meeting. The airport authority has said that they will give an oral reply, and detailed information will be provided in a moment. And I'd like to say this to members, that this morning we have tabled the letter from Mr. Eddie Chu to the subcommittee. Our legal advisor, Mr. Low, has been invited to come to the meeting. Regarding this letter to the subcommittee, there is this cover letter and also some appendices. But we believe there may be legal issues attending these appendices. Can I hand over to the legal advisor? Thank you, Chairman. Members, Mr. Chu has written a two-page letter to the subcommittee, and in it he mentions an anonymous letter. And the anonymous letter has been seen by me. The letter makes rather serious accusations against certain individuals and two companies. Members will understand that when you speak here and also at the Council, we are covered and exempted by the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance, but the Secretariat is not. So we have to be very careful when we circulate such letters to members. We have looked at the cover letter by Mr. Eddie Chu. There are over 20 questions. Those are very comprehensible questions. Therefore, I don't think it is necessary to attach or circulate the anonymous letter to members. This is to steer clear of any possible legal liabilities. I also like to add a word. Normally speaking, at our meetings, we have to be very careful in dealing with anonymous letters because we wouldn't know who the complainant is. If libel is involved, for example, even if we are covered by the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance, we need to act with caution. Thank you very much. Right. I'd like to welcome the administration team attending the meeting. I think you know that a member of the subcommittee, Mr. Eddie Chu, has written to the subcommittee. And I know you are clear about that. First, I'd like to ask Mr. Eddie Chu to say something, and then you can respond. Mr. Eddie Chu is due to arrive. Well, since the complaining member is not here, well, this is of public concern, and there is wide coverage in the press. Okay, we would not wait for Mr. Eddie Chu, but we'll now ask the Bureau to respond to the questions raised in Mr. Eddie Chu's letter. Chairman, I understand from you that we should discuss the letter first, or should we go by the agenda first? The letter has to do with environment issues, and perhaps we can deal with the presentation under item 2 first, and then the airport authority representatives can explain the relevant issues. What do you think, Chairman? members. Perhaps we can wait for Mr. Eddie Chu to come back first. Sorry, speaker not coming through. Let us deal with the agenda item, and then at the same time, we can include this sandfill issue. Ms. Tanya Chan. I don't think we need to wait for any particular member. I understand, Chairman, you want to manage time. We can have the PowerPoint presentation first, and I know that the sandfill issue is one of the items in the environment permit. Perhaps we can deal with that when we come to the environment permit. Okay, why don't we do that? The Bureau, can you now introduce the PowerPoint? Can I defer to the Airport Authority to do so? Thank you, Chairman and members. Is the projector working? Why don't you just do it orally, because we have a copy of the PowerPoint with us anyway. Thank you, Chairman and members. As we start construction, and in response to the requirements of the environment permit, we have set up a dedicated team to deal with the environment measures. We have directly engaged three consultancy teams. First, environmental team. It is responsible for EM&A, and we also have an independent environmental checker who will audit the overall EM&A performance and verify relevant submissions under the EP. Also, we have the environmental permit consultant who assists the AA to comply with marine ecology and fisheries related EP submissions. The advance works started at the end of 2015. According to the EP, before we start any construction, we need to take a series of measures, including the engagement of the ET and the IEC, and also we need to do baseline monitoring of air quality and noise, and we must set up a dedicated website to report EM&A information. On the 1st of August 2016, and actually before we formally started our marine works, again we had to comply with other requirements under the EP, including baseline monitoring for Chinese white dolphins and water quality. Also, we need to submit papers to the EPD, including the translocation plan of coral and also dolphin exclusion zone plan, etc. And at the same time, we should implement management plans, including the speed ferry control zone and also waste management plan. And then after we started the marine works on the 1st of August 2016, we had to continue with water quality impact monitoring, CWD impact monitoring, and also we also implemented the construction vessels plan and also a dolphin exclusion zone plan. Within our environment monitoring system, we do detailed monitoring of CWD. This is on the left of the slide. And the scope of monitoring also includes West Lantau and Southwest Lantau. When we did the assessment, it is expected that during the construction works, dolphins would steer clear of our construction area and would go to other areas in Lantau, so we monitored a bigger area to see the travel zones of dolphins and how that would change. Apart from vessel-based survey, we also do land-based survey. In Long Ku Chau and Sha Chau, we have below water sound monitoring to try to see where dolphins are going. And also, to the north of Lantau, where there are residential dwellings, we have done dust and noise monitoring. Also, as you know, water quality may be affected by reclamation. So if you look at the bottom right-hand corner, we have set up 22 monitoring points, 12 of which are within 500 meters of the boundary of the reclamation zone. That will be a kind of boundary check. If we should see a deterioration in water quality there, we would have to take action to minimize the impact. And also in sensitive receivers, say near marine parks and also in North Lantau, before the water quality there will deteriorate, we have to take action. And also, if there is the sighting of coral, we have to do monitoring as well, and whether water quality is changing for the entire large area. Because as you know, our water quality to the west of Hong Kong is very much affected by the Pearl Estuary.
Water quality upstream is deteriorating. We will be able to monitor that. All the, such information, I think, have been put onto a dedicated website according to the requirement of the EP, and all the submissions we give to, report to the EPD are also uploaded onto the website. Also, we have a community liaison group, and also we have the two enhancement funds, and details of which are also put onto the website. Amongst all the mitigating measures, one of such measures would be the impact on the CWDs. At the Sky Pier at the moment, we have vessels which travel west, you know, passing through the airport island to Zhuhai. Because of the reclamation project, during the reclamation period, the route will be realigned. Because we want to minimize the impact of high-speed ferries on the China white dolphins, and therefore we have proposed that the route of the high-speed vessels will be changed. And so you see the red line here. We all know that the Brothers Islands and Long Ku Chau, this is the area where the CWD very often would appear. And this is the area which is shaded green. So for the high-speed vessels passing through that area, we are requiring them to reduce the speed from 30 to below 15 knots. And such measures were implemented since the end of 2015. Other than following the dedicated routes and maintaining the required speed, they cannot, you know, go beyond the northern part of the island. And in order to also, we would limit the frequency of these high-speed vessels for no more than 150 per day and 99 respectively. Other than that, we have other mitigating measures. We've set up a marine traffic control center where we would require the high-speed vessels and the construction vessels. They would need to be installed with tracking devices so that we'll be able to identify the location, the route, and the speed of such vessels in order that we can monitor whether or not they are implementing the measures according to plan. On board such vessels, there are mechanical devices, the vibration of which may cause noise nuisance, which will affect the dolphins. And therefore, we have also required them to install acoustic insulation devices. We've also set up a marine dolphin control area. We would have observers on board the construction vessels within the boundary of 250 meters. If they identify any dolphins, then any such construction works would need to cease until the dolphin has moved away from the site by more than 250 meters. In the environmental report, we've also conducted an assessment of the corals. To the north of the airport island, we noticed that there are some corals, but they are very common species in the with no particular conservation value. According to the EP, it was concluded that we do not need to conduct put in place any preventive measures, but we do need to translocate such corals. So before work began, we conducted some surveys, and I'm going to show members a very short video about these such corals. This is actually the location of the corals we have found to the north of the airport island. Here the water is not so clear. So this is some location where we have found the boulders and the corals, which look like a finger here. They're white in color. And the second location is to the northeastern corner of the airport island, where we have smaller boulders. And there we've also found some corals. In the translocation plan, we have to consider whether or not the corals could be transplanted, because if we could successfully, I think if we were to relocate both the corals and the rocks to which they are attached to, the chances of survival will be higher. So we would need to engage divers to help us do that. Normally, we would translate rocks which are about half a meter in diameter together with the corals. And we found that a suitable reception area would be at Yam Chai Wan. And this is a picture of what Yam Chai Wan is like. You find that the corals here are relatively larger in size. And this is where suitable habitat for the corals to grow. We have already submitted our translocation plan to the EPD, and we've also briefed the ACE on the proposal. At the end of last year, we've already translocated 300 such coral groups and the boulders to an area at Yam Chai Wan, and we are now carrying out a post-transplantation monitoring. Other than the translocation of the corals, in response to the concern expressed by the ACE, we've also conducted a study on transplantation. So because there's a bigger chance for the corals to survive if we take the transplantation study. That is, we would cut off the corals, but the mortality rate is relatively higher if we take this approach. But in response to the ACE's request, we conducted a study and we engaged a coral expert from the Hong Kong University and another professor from to help us from New York University to help us conduct a study. Early this year, we've already collected some some of the corals have now been translocated to Yam Chai Wan, and we are now conducting post-transplantation monitoring program, which will take about 3 months. Another important mitigating measures in the environment report is that we need to build a marine park. The idea is that we want to connect the current marine park at Sa Chow and the Brothers Islands Marine Park and the restricted zone at the airport. So this will link up with marine protection zone for China white dolphins in the mainland. So the marine park is about 2,400 hectares. Together with the other protected zones, including the other marine parks, the total size is more than 5,000 hectares. To date, in March last year, we already submitted the marine park study to the ACE, and after that, we completed a report on our initial feasibility study. At the end of this year and early next year, we will be starting the first round of stakeholder consultation, including the marine operators, the fishermen, the green groups, and relevant advisory committees. After we've done the first round, we will proceed with the detailed study report, and then we'll fine-tune our proposals before we go for the second round of consultation, and then we will complete the ultimate final report and go through the statutory procedures. So the marine park project will be completed before the beginning of the third runway project. During the construction period, we would also like to come up with some arrangements. So in the environmental report, we are required to set up two funds. One is the Marine Ecology Enhancement Fund and the other Fisherman's Enhancement Fund, so that we will be able to achieve the conservation objective in a sustainable manner. So we hope that we can generate an investment return on such funds. We hope that we will be able to have a return of a total annual allocation of $6 million for the Marine Ecology Enhancement Fund and $4 million for the Fisheries Enhancement Fund. There will be a steering committee to monitor the financial sustainability of both funds, and our CEO will be the chairman of the committee. In selecting the projects for these funds, this will be the responsibility of the two committees. The chairman of the two management committees are representatives from the AA. The AA will also be the secretariat for both committees. At the end of last year, we already set up both management committees. And for the MEEF, we have a professor from the City University and also representatives from green groups and academics, including dolphin experts. For the FEF Management Committee, again, we have Professor Lang Mei Yi, who is the chair, and other members include the Fishermen's Association reps and experts. Progress to date for the MEEF Management Fund. After we set up the committee last year, starting from December last year until the end of January or February, we've already the deadline for application has been passed, and we are now vetting the applications, and we will be announcing the result of the application shortly. So today, up to now, we have been paying a lot of attention to connection with the stakeholders, and we've set up the community liaison groups, including the five communities in the proximity of the airport, including Islands, Sha Tin, Kwai Chung, Chin Wan, and including community leaders, district council, and so on. And 8 meetings have been convened so far. And we've conducted more than 8 site visits. Among the professional liaison groups, we have participation from different professionals, and different meetings have been convened. We briefed the members about progress of our works, and we also collected their views. Another important stakeholder will be the fishermen, and since 2012, we have had more than 30 engagement exercises with them. At the end of last year, we set up the fishermen liaison group to collect their views regarding our works. At the end of last year, we conducted 2 briefings in respect of the FEF. Thank you. Thank you. It is now time for members to ask questions. Chairman. Will the Bureau also be, giving us, a response regarding the issue of marine sand? Dr. Kikikwa, I don't think we have too much time for questions. I propose that we allow them to speak first before we ask our questions, because Mr. Ji is already here. Mr. Ji has already arrived, but understand that at 8:30 this morning, he submitted another paper. I don't know whether you've submitted the paper to the Bureau as well. No, you have not. Will the secretaries please also circulate this document to the officials and the AA? I hope Mr. Eddie, now that he has arrived, will you first of all walk us through your letter? Chairman, I don't need to do that, Chairman. I think this has been already reported in the media. I'm sure the Bureau already may have some thoughts on this. So I agree with Dr. Kwok that we can ask the Bureau to respond first. So the Bureau is aware of the questions raised by Mr. Chu. Yes, Chairman. I can invite our colleagues from the AA to give a preliminary response to the reports in the media. What I'd like to ask, whether or not you understand the questions raised by Mr. Eddie G. You are aware, you know about such questions. Yes, our colleagues from the AA is aware of those questions. Well, in that case, we'll ask the Bureau to directly give us the response to those questions.
Right.
Airport Authority.
Despite the fact that the letter was anonymous, obviously we look into these allegations because we have very serious, take the compliance with the material specification of the reclamation and also the compliance with the environmental permit conditions very seriously. We've looked into these allegations and we found them to be unsubstantiated and with a number of misconceptions. Let me clarify. The use of different materials in the reclamation from multiple sources has long been in the planning for the reclamation. The use of these different fill materials is allowable under our technical specification and also providing it meets the requirements of the environmental permit in terms of the maximum fines content. It is entirely in accordance with our environmental impact and the environmental permit. Let me make it quite plain. The maximum fines content, which is specified in the environmental permit, is also specified in our contractual conditions, and those have not been changed. The contractor is responsible for supplying the sand in accordance with the specification, and the authority ensures strict compliance with respect to the quality and the source of those materials. Specifically, we require testing of the source materials. We also inspect those sources and we also carry out tests of the material delivered from every single sand barge delivering the fill materials. To date, approximately 800 samples have been tested and I can report that all of the tests show complete compliance with the EP and the technical specifications.
Okay.
Okay, you have heard the response of the AA. I will now allow members to ask questions. First one, Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, to be followed by Dr. K.K. Kwok. I'll allow members 5 minutes each, including a reply. Thank you, Chairman. Chairman, the AA just now explained their control of marine fill material and the major principles attending to that. However, there is a lot of media coverage this time around, and there is also the mention of an anonymous letter. But then we have heard certain rather substantial detail in that letter and also in questions raised by Mr. Eddie Chu. So I'd like to seek more information. Of course, I understand you use different material for reclamation, and the composition of the material will depend on the actual usage, and they are subject to different specifications. That would include rock, sand. Sand would include natural or artificial sand. And I believe in terms of project design, all that should be specified. Reclamation for 3RS of course, has also to comply with environment requirements, and I'm sure those standards are stringent. Now, since there are these rather specific allegations, and in Mr. Eddie Chu's letter, even company names are mentioned. Mr. Chairman, I can also say that, of course, we are covered by the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance with regard to our oral remarks made at meetings of the Council and also our written submissions. But since that anonymous letter is giving specific information, even including company names, well, I think that is not very appropriate. But, Chairman, it's up to you to decide. Since there are these specific allegations, I would like the AA to explain. Well, you don't have to mention the company names, but have you done any investigation into the allegations mentioned in the anonymous letter to see whether they are substantiated in any way? What is your understanding and what is the result of your investigation, if any? Who will take the question?
Thank you for the question. As I said, we have investigated these anonymous allegations. We've looked at them and found no factual basis. You're right, there are very specific references to a company. I have to say, as I've said already, that the responsibility for supply of the materials, whether they be the quarried sand or manufactured sand or from whatever source, is the responsibility of the contractor who has to comply with the specification. He's choose all of the contractors, and there's not just one, are choosing multiple sources of material at the moment. Each of those sources are looked into. The contractor is, it's a material supply, so he's not so much subcontracting the works. He is using a number of contractors and a number of sources to obtain those materials. The named company is actually, I can say, one of the agents assisting the contractor. Just one of the agents, and certainly the quite independently, the sources of material come from different sources. They are delivered by different means, from barges, and are distributed into the reclamation fill. And so we can ensure compliance with the materials, but as I say, by testing each delivery of material. So we found these allegations as they are unsubstantiated.
Chairman, regarding the monitoring of materials and also the workflow, I'd like to know how that is done. I'd like to have a supplementary paper after the meeting. That is regarding the monitoring of the workflow for the supply of marine fill material. I'd like to know how you do your quality management and also supplier management. Maybe I cannot get all the details today, but I'd like to have a supplementary paper on that. Can that be done? The AA is, you have heard Mr. Low. Please supply a document after the meeting. Is that all right? Next member, Dr. K.K. Kwok, to be followed by Dr. Cheng Chong Tai. Thank you, Chairman. We should not regard anonymous letters with too much weight, and we always have to be cautious about anonymous letters. But we have to be careful this time because the 3RS is using over $141 billion and over $60 billion will be spent on fill material. And according to reporting, marine sand has become much more expensive in the last half to a year. We believe the source of marine sand is mainly from companies on the mainland. From what we already know, very often they are state-owned enterprises. Of course, we rely very much on the monitoring mechanism. And just now, the AA can actually certify within just one day that the allegations are unsubstantiated. I am worried that your answer may not be very mature, because if you can complete investigation within just 24 hours and to say that there is no evidence, you have to tell us why there is no evidence. You have to let us know the details of your investigation and how you arrived at the conclusion that the allegations are unsubstantiated, or else you are just like the people making the allegations, that you are saying this without a lot of backing. This is not unacceptable. Secondly, marine sand prices. I'd like to ask whether this is the incentive for many suppliers and contractors for them to mix low-quality sand in their future supplies. Secondly, what is the present price for marine sand with the presence of speculation? Is it that that would amount to more than $64 billion and above? What is the present estimate of the price of marine sand for this project? And also, the environment will be affected by this project, of course, but you depend on the environmental team and the independent environmental checker. My question is for the government. What is the role of the administration in this? Because we cannot totally rely on the AA. I'd like to ask what the administration does in this project. You know, there are these serious allegations about the use of low-quality sand fill material, which is not according to contract standards. Now, I'd like to ask whether the administration is doing anything on site or through the coordination office to make sure, you know, what is true and what is not true. And lastly, the AA has documents, they say, to show that the allegations are unsubstantiated. Will the administration further check and verify the answers? Who will take those questions? Chairman, let me say something first. We are aware of anonymous letters. We have received that letter as well. We, of course, attach weight to such allegations. The supply of marine sand to the AA is related to a contractual relationship with the suppliers. The AA has to make sure that the marine sand is complying with the standards in the EP. And at the time of the sand coming into Hong Kong, if the supplier does not provide true information, the Customs and Excise can certainly take follow-up action. And secondly, during reclamation, if the sand fill material will cause water pollution in exceedance of the requirements under the EP, the EPD can also take action. Dr. Kwok made a point which should be clarified by the AA, because he mentioned that the marine sand will cost $600 billion. I think the AA should clarify that figure. And the next question should be taken by the AA. The AA, please. Chairman, I was talking about the overall reclamation project, not just the price of marine sand. Let me clarify that first. Okay, so the AA doesn't have to give a reply? No, I'm asking them about the price of marine sand. I think I need an answer on that.
Say that the marine sand, as we said before, is in accordance with our expectations in the original budget, and the procurement of the contracts, including the supply of sand, which is only an element, don't forget. The sand cost is one element of the cost. There's also the very extreme cost of actually transporting the material and placing it into the reclamation, along with many other aspects of those reclamation costs. It's in accordance with the market prices that we anticipated when we did the tender, and I'm very pleased that when we awarded the contracts, they were within our budgets.
So what is the total price you have paid for marine sand?
So expected, or
the actual cost is within the rates of the contract for both the supply of the sand and also the placing and very many other aspects of it. The actual element of the sand cost itself is very commercially sensitive, and as we've indicated before, we would prefer not to make that available.
Okay.
Next member, Dr. Cheng Chong Tai, and then Mr. Eddie Chu. Thank you, Chairman. We understand we are talking about Gold Mountain Marine Engineering Company, which is supplying low-quality material. Dr. Chang, please, I remind you that we don't want to point our finger at any company. No, I am reading from material you have supplied us. No, it is not from us. It is from Mr. Eddie Chu. At the beginning of the meeting, I already said so. Okay. Well, you can say a company, Dr. Chang. I'm reading from the letter in front of me, and there are other members at the meeting who are questioning the 3RS project and one company from the mainland that it is supplying substandard material, and also they are not supplying true information for customs clearance. In the same letter, it is mentioned that some Hong Kong people have rejected a certain consignment, and when they did testing on barges, they also rejected the marine sand because it was substandard. I'd like to ask the Bureau or the AA, can you give us information about that period? That is from the 11th to the 24th of March, when you received the marine sand material. What papers did you have? Because we can compare the papers to see whether this allegation is backed. Who has the information?
Yeah, I would like to take the question.
Point out, as you say, it was not an anonymous letter received at the end of last week, so we had more than 24 hours to research into it. The importance and the of the compliance of the material with our specifications is very important to us in terms of inclusion in the works, but also in making sure that they comply with the requirements of the environmental permit. So we test every barge that arrives on site. As to the allegation in the letter that a barge was turned away, that was not our staff, if that happened at all. So we have tested every barge that's come. We are looking to make sure that every barge of material that is delivered into the site complies with our specification and that of the environmental permit. And to date, with almost 800 individual tests, we are showing complete compliance.
In other words, for the time being, the AA has not provided any specific timetables to refute the claim here. Is that a correct understanding? So far, you do not have any specific information to verify or otherwise that the claim.
Into the claim, it's an anonymous claim with a number of accusations, and we found none of them to be substantiated. Many of those accusations are related to a complete misunderstanding of our specification and what's required. There is no specification requirement that it is only marine sand that will be used in the reclamation.
Chairman, I think we need to base our discussion on facts. Of course, we are all worried that there's, all you need to do is to tell us, give us information regarding the sand which you took delivery of on the 11th and 24th of March to show whether or not the sand delivered during that period were not up to standard and that they are not in compliance with the requirements according to the import regulations. So since the AA doesn't provide any concrete information, I don't think we can pursue this further.
We have not tested and found any sample to be failing, so we haven't rejected. That's quite very clear. I can tell you that now.
I think the explanation by the AA is that they have not tested. No, my understanding is that it is not that they have not tested the material. It's just that they have not rejected delivery of any such materials. They are saying that according to the tests that they've done, the material supply were normal. My understanding is this is their answer. That's why I said that on the 11th of 24th of March, I think during that period, there have been instances where the materials, the delivery of the materials were initially rejected, but subsequently you accept the delivery of these materials reluctantly.
Every barge that's come in, each of those barges has passed. We have not tested and rejected, nor have we turned away a barge from our staff. Is that as clear? There is no rejection. There is no material
okay.
that's failed and rejected.
My
understanding of the answer is that this has never happened. That is, the two dates in March that you mentioned, that there had not been any instances during which the sand delivered had been rejected. Chairman, my question is very simple. There must have been documents regarding custom decorations and the testing of the sand materials.
And have documentation of all of the materials we test. In terms of custom documentation, the quarried sand doesn't require that custom documentation. Other sands from other sources do, but I'm telling you that the materials, vast majority of the materials delivered to date have come from quarries. It's a manufactured sand and doesn't require any importation license, nor does it include under Sand Ordinance 147 any requirement.
Okay. 好了,下一位, 朱凱迪議員
Mr. Adiju. Thank you, Chairman. Having heard the AA, I find this really ludicrous. You're now saying that today we're talking about the environment and therefore the EP standard is that anything you drop into the sea, so long as the particles you deposit into the sea is up to standard, it would be okay. They don't care where the sand comes from. They say this is the responsibility of the contractor. So what I want to ask is this. Is it like what is claimed in this anonymous letter that we have sand stolen from the western waters of Shenzhen for the 3RS project and the AA doesn't care about that? Is it that if the sand had been stolen and you still don't care because the size of the sand particles are up to standard? And secondly, we have been talking about marine sand. At the meeting in October, in response to a question from Mr. Jeremy Tam, we were talking about marine sand. If now we're saying that we do not necessarily procure marine sand, and rock dust could also be used in large quantities to replace marine sand. If that's the case, I hope the AA could clarify that. In this anonymous complaint letter, they have also attached certain invoices. After reading the invoices, I now have a better understanding as to why some contractors might have used rock dust to replace marine sand. It all comes down to simple economics because it's a lot cheaper. According to the few invoices that we've read, whether it's the invoices from the C&E department and from the forwarder, it's all specifically mentioned that they are related to the 3RS project, and it's also about the contractor Chun Hua and also the CHEG, the JV company. And here they refer to a batch of rock dust. There were 4,510 tons, and the cost is $30 per ton. Dr. Kwok already said that the price of marine sand is now $100 per ton. Obviously, if you have a substitute costing $30 a ton and you accept delivery and you dump them into the sea, then the contractor will make a windfall of $70. So are you saying that marine sand and rock dust for the AA and the TXB are not different at all? Two questions, please. Now, who would like to take the question?
So I can start. Can I just refute? We do care very much where the materials come from. We when the contractor proposes a source, which are quarries, at the moment the majority of sources coming from quarries in the mainland, we visit that source and check it's appropriate. As I say, we then check every barge load of material to make sure it complies with our specification. Our specification does not require marine sand. It requires sand within a certain criteria. It gives a technical evaluation of the particle size distribution, and it also, in accordance with the environmental permit, has a maximum fines content. This is to help control the impact on water quality. So we ensure that, the material sources and also the materials delivered comply with that. So I'm not sure why you'd say we don't care. We do care very much about where the material comes from. And as I say, we have not ever confined ourselves to marine sand. The cost, I can't comment on the cost from previously of $130, I think you said, for marine sand. I suspect that is not the cost. That may be a cost for river sand, which is a completely different material that we're not using. As I said before, we have anticipated in our budget a cost of sand to be used in the reclamation, and I'm pleased, as I've said,
I
only have 10 seconds left. Why do we have such complaints letters? Because in the procurement of the sand materials, the Bureau and A has been not been transparent at all. They say that the price has not exceeded the budget, but it not told us where they procure the sand and what is the cost.
我想对,
I think, does the Bureau have any response to the allegation by Mr. Zhu that you're operating within this large black box? Tell me how much it cost, how much you spend to procure the sand, where does the sand come from? What is the amount on the invoice?
Said the sand is one component of the reclamation cost. The cost of delivery and the cost of placing and all the reclamation costs exceed the cost of the sand within that contract. It's only one element. As I said, we had estimates before we started on what the cost, the market cost of the sand would be, and that is commercially sensitive within the contract, but it's within our expectations and our estimate.
Next. Mr. Yu Si-wing, thank you. I don't think we should respond to an anonymous complaint letter, but of course, given the concern by the public, we should give an appropriate response. But I think it would be best for Mr. Zhu and our members to. Well, after they've asked the questions, we get a written response. Otherwise, if the Bureau or the AA say something wrong and then we would, you know, belabor that point, I think, is there any economic motive or political motive behind the anonymous complaint, whether or not the person lost a bid and made a complaint? We don't know the reason behind it. Everything now is speculation at this moment. So I don't think this is not the right way to resolve the issue. And it would also be unfair to the AA. So my question is that it's about the two funds, the MEEF and the MEEF funds. There are two funds respectively. So for the last 2 years, I'd like to know how much of the fund have you spent? Have you, and also for marine ecology, according to the way the fund is being dispensed at the moment, do you think the size of the fund is enough? And do you think there's a need to adjust the size of the fund? Thank you, Mr. Yeo. Our fund has a capital injection of $400 million. The two funds are $150 million. Of course, we would like to generate an investment return on both funds, and the return will be used to sustain the operation of the fund. We base our initial projection of a return of 4%, which is 4 to 6 million respectively. But now we realize it's difficult to achieve that rate of return. We have another top-up fund of 100 million. So if we cannot make the expected rate of return, then we'll buy some fund from the top-up fund. The fund was, well, we only began to accept application at the end of last year. Deadline was at the end of January and February, respectively, this year. And the respective committees are now vetting those applications. Hopefully, by the middle of this year, we'll be able to announce the names of the successful applicants. We hope that it will be sustainable. We hope that the fund will be able to, entertain applications every year. But I can say also that we have a large number of applications for the first year, and the amount applied for far exceeded the 6 million. So at the moment, so you have a separate fund to deal with the impact of the 3RS projects on the environment. Yes. In the EP, there are various measures we are required to adopt to protect the environment, and these are the measures which the AA has to pay for. So this is something extra. In other words, going forward, the diversion of the high-speed ferries and the enhancement measures, all these will be paid for out of by other funds. So you're spending a lot of money to protect the CWD and the corals and to, so do you have any such data? Well, regarding the whole project, we have spent more than $20 million on environmental protection and green design. For example, the series of mitigating measures that we've adopted and also green construction projects. And so on.
What about the environment experts? How many are there in your whole team? Well, we have directly engaged three consultant companies. In fact, the EP has a lot of requirements and it requires different experts and professionals. Some of the experts work full-time, some only provide part-time support, but we are talking about dozens of experts. Mr. Ted Hoy, to be followed by Mr. Stephen Ho. Thank you, Chair. If there is sandfill material which pollutes the water and which should not have gone into the ocean but has gone into the ocean anyway, that will affect marine ecology. It is going to be an ecology disaster. Even if the complainant is anonymous, the administration has the responsibility to tell members the truth. I hope you understand that members always have this inquisitive attitude because we are trying to protect the interests of the public. The AA gave answers just now, saying that they conducted an investigation and it is said that the complaint is unsubstantiated. Well, you worked fast, even if you were given 48 hours. However, even if you say it is unsubstantiated, I would expect you to supply a paper to tell us what kind of sand you have used for reclamation, where did they come from, and how did you do the testing, and how did they come to Hong Kong? Is it by water-based transportation? You said you did 800 tests and you did not turn away any delivery. But procedurally, if you have done the testing, but then people would have swapped the supply of sand, and the reports are that they are substandard, and also there has been swapping of deliveries. I would say that you need to supply a paper to explain the issue. I don't think you can dismiss it by saying that it is unsubstantiated. I think you have not explained all the details. And also, you said many times, and members asked many times, about the buying of sand and the price. You say it is commercially sensitive. Is it that really commercially sensitive? Because if you can't tell us how much you spend on sand, then maybe you are giving us the feeling that perhaps you have gone for cheaper sand and the source of which cannot be explained. I mean, you are giving me this feeling. Because if you can't even tell me the price of the materials, you don't even have to tell us the contract sum. I think you need to operate with more transparency. And then lastly, the administration. I think there should be different layers of monitoring, right? The AA is saying that it is unsubstantiated. But now we don't have any documents. You are just telling us within a few minutes, orally, that we have to trust you. But then I think the administration should do your own independent study or investigation. Who would take those questions?
I just clarify, as I say, the sand, we don't specify marine sand, we specify sand by the grading and the various requirements in the contract. The contractor is free to, and there are many contractors, not just one contractor providing sand, they're free to source that material, and they have contracted to do so in our contract. The reason I'm reluctant to give away the price of the sand within that contract is, as I say, it's in accordance with market conditions, but it is nonetheless commercially sensitive. I can say that the cost of the crushed or the quarried sand that has been the subject of much debate this morning is roughly equivalent to the same cost as of marine sand. It's not a huge difference in cost. They're pretty much proportionally the same. And they are only one element of the reclamation cost. And regarding your concern about how we monitor and fill, we do test every single barge of material as it's delivered. And all those tests have shown that the sand is fully in compliance. I'd like to emphasize that. And we've already been asked to provide a supplementary paper on explaining the source of sand and how we manage that process through from source to delivery.
I'd like to follow up. You emphasized many times that the sand price is only part of the contract. There is also transportation and other parts of the project. Is it that you don't know the price?
Not that I don't know the price. I'm just to say it's commercially sensitive, but it is it's only a percentage of the actual total construction costs of the reclamation.
But you don't want to tell us, and you are saying it is a commercial secret. Well, what will it affect if you say it is a commercial secret? What kind of impact will there be, even if you divulge the information?
As I say, it is commercially sensitive to the contracts themselves. We have a number of contracts. There are, in total, there are going to be six contracts. Many of those themselves have to provide sand for their works.
Well, we are talking about the unit cost of material. This is very basic information. We want to know the quality of the material. If you can't even tell me that, I think there is something you are hiding. Next member, Mr. Stephen Ho, to be followed by Ms. Tanya Chan. Thank you, Chairman. I have to declare that I am a non-executive director of the AA. Well, this whole issue is raised by an anonymous letter, and I agree with Mr. Yu Si Wing that it seems we are doing a much too in-depth investigation into the matter. But then, of course, if there is public concern, we need to say something and do something. But Mr. Ted Hui said that this is a marine disaster. I think that is premature. We need to clarify certain things first. First of all, the procurement of marine sand and the testing standard. I hope the Bureau and the AA can explain the procedures to us. And secondly, whether this is a marine disaster. At the beginning, you said you did 10 to 20 water quality tests. Even fishermen have questions to ask about such tests. But this time around, if, as said in the letter, there is substandard sand fill material used, will it have any impact on the environment? Because we have to know that before we can say it is a marine disaster or not. And number three, when you accept the deliveries or even other materials other than marine sand, can you step up your measures in so doing? Say, for example, even for imported vegetables, the lorries would come in and then we would open the compartment and then we would only test the first or two baskets. That will not be comprehensive. And in this letter, it is said that some substandard material is hidden under the first layer of marine sand. Of course, you would get samples. Maybe the sample should not be taken just from the first or top layer to make sure that the marine sand will be good for the marine environment.
And briefly, I think the vegetable analogy is very equivalent because we do look and open every barge delivering material we take a test from. All of those tests have shown that the material is compliant with our specifications. So I don't accept that there's a marine disaster because I believe that all the material we've placed is in accordance with our specification. But I'll just hand over to my colleague because remember, the maximum fines content is one requirement as to how we...
Sorry, Chairman, I'd like to ask a supplementary question about the polluted water. Can I ask you whether your water monitoring can check that there is substandard material used?
That, as I say, the fines content is only one element of what we're doing. We also, of course, carefully monitor the actual results, the water quality. So I'll hand over to Peter to give us information.
Mr. Lee, thank you, Chair. In monitoring water quality, as you know, reclamation may cause a water quality problem because suspended particulates could be generated. And that is because we have fine content in the fill material. If there is a high proportion of fine content, there will be more opportunity for pollution. And of course, we would check the concentration and ratio of fine content of the fill material. And we also check whether the procedures are correct. As I said, we have 12 monitoring points within 500 meters of the reclamation area, and we have not seen any exceedance of indicators at the 12 points. We can also check the water quality around marine parks, which are sensitive receivers, and we have not seen any pollution. And if indeed we should see any exceedance at the monitoring points, we will examine our procedures to see whether we need to do any adjustment to reduce water quality a problem. Are you going to step up your monitoring procedures? What is the present procedure like? Can you tell us about that? Yes. There are two parts. One, we would do tests at the barges. We can go back and to see whether we can step up the procedure. But as for water quality, our present requirement is that every week, we do three rounds of water sampling. And every time we do so at high tide and also at ebbs. And we are talking about hundreds of water samples taken. We hope we can check the actual situation through such sampling. As for the testing of barge deliveries, we can go back and look at the procedures to see whether that can be stepped up. But actually, after taking a sample, we'll send the sample to an independent laboratory where the requirements are checked vis-a-vis fine content. And up to this day, everything has been found to be compliant. Next, Ms. Tanya Chen, to be followed by Mr. Leung Yu Chong. Thank you, Chair. After following this discussion, I have these questions. You said many times about the delivery test at barges. Is it that you would do testing on every barge delivery, each and every one? And many members showed the same concern. And Mr. Poole mentioned that contractually, there are requirements about grading requirements and contractors. I'd like to know whether you can give us a paper to let us know your requirements on grading and also requirements on sand and how many contractors you use. Can we have a paper detailing all that, please? And also, I like a table. You said you have done 800 tests. Is it possible for you to list the test dates and the sand volume and also what tests have been taken? I have got this in my hand. Environment Permit 489/2014 at 2.26. This is about fine content requirement. And all that is written in the EP. I'd like to ask for a list or a table, please, including the test dates, the barge size, meaning the tonnage, and also what have been tested and the results. You said again, time and again, that every time you have done the test, you did not reject any delivery. I'd like to have a table, please. Is that possible, please, to alleviate the public's worries?
We've paper on the how we're monitoring marine fill. We can certainly add those data information you've asked for.
Thank you. 另外呢,因为就住这个,虽然
also, although this is an anonymous letter, they mentioned the specific days of March 24th, during which certain delivery of sand had been rejected. I'd like to ask, in respect of this incident, did this incident happen on the 24th of March? According to your information.
As far as information, we rejected no barge.
Okay.
In or around those
days.
Anything happened on the 24th of March, Mr. Chen? I think Mr. Kevin already gave us a very clear answer, Mr. Poole. No, never mind. I'll follow up on that later. But Chairman, I'm more concerned about the non-dredge. Reclamation. Recently, there was an incident in Zhuhai, and I don't know how the bureau said. He said an incident happened at the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge. The so-called non-dredging approach, according to the bureau, for the HCMB, there is a temporary reclamation there. For the 3RS, my understanding is that you will be also adopting the non-dredging approach. Will there be temporary reclamation to actually sustain what you have already reclaimed? And if it's not necessary, is it that there are unique requirements at the Hong Kong connection point that you need to have a temporary reclamation to sort of hold it together temporarily?
Anticipate a temporary reclamation, and we are using non-dredged methods. We're using, however, extensively deep cement mixing, which to my knowledge wasn't used extensively on the BCF, and our seawall design is very different from that which was used on the Zhuhai Macau Bridge facility.
I am very interested in the non-dredging approach. Earlier, at the location of the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, that was the first time an incident happened. So I hope that if there is the opportunity, I can ask the AA to brief us on the reclamation, 650 hectares of reclamation. You're also adopting the non-dredging approach. How can you ensure that you will not need to have any temporary reclamation? Because so far I still don't... I hope they will give us a briefing. Chairman, I hope you understand this project, the non-dredging approach is a new technology. I think, Chairman, Ms. Chen, also, we will have a site visit. Well, I don't think we can actually see the reclamation process. I hope they can give us a slide to show us. But they don't have the slides now yet. I'm not talking about today, Chairman. Also, the advanced sea walls. I hope they can also provide us with such information. The 200 meters and so on. I'd like to know more about that as well. Could the Bureau or the AA provide us with such information? Next, Mr. Leung Yeo Chong, followed by Mr. Leung Kok Hong. Thank you. Although this is an anonymous letter, but the question is that even if it is an anonymous letter and whatever the motive behind it, be it economic or political, I don't think we need to care so much about that. What we need to know is whether or not the allegations are true. Today, what we need to look at and find out is whether or not the claims made in this letter is true. What I've heard today explanation from the AA. They say that they've conducted tests and they found everything to be in order. They've not rejected delivery of any of such materials. But I've not heard the government tell us that they've conducted any investigation. Even for the pollution of the environment, it was only the colleagues from the AA to tell us what they've done regarding the tests that they've carried out. But what about the government? Have they conducted, you know, counter tests or investigation? I think this is very important. This is not only, we're not only talking about, you know, a simple project. This is a huge project covering a very large area with serious implications. So far, we've not seen any answers from the government. Could the government give us a full account of the investigation that they've done in respect of this incident? And secondly, colleagues have talked about the incident in which sand had been stolen and then shipped to Hong Kong. And the only answer we gave was that's not true. So regarding such allegations, these are not minor allegations, it's a very serious allegation. Doesn't the government have the responsibility to find out and investigate whether or not this has happened? And if not, could they give us more information? And secondly, the AA said everything was in order. So in the government's investigation, could they tell us, announce the results of the AA investigation and also the results of the government's investigation to see whether or not there's any discrepancy? Only by so doing can the public's concern be allayed. Thank you. I think the Secretary may have to answer the question. Chairman, at the beginning of our meeting, I've already answered the same question. Mr. Leung was not here yet. So the role of the government is that well, of course, we believe that the AA and the contractors as a contract in respect of the quality of the sand material, that is the major responsibility of the AA. But if the sand material used in reclamation has caused pollution and the extent of the pollution exceeded the requirements of the EP, then the EPD will follow up accordingly and even take enforcement action. So government departments will monitor that. Our colleagues from the AA have told members that so far the water quality monitoring station has not detected any exceedance of the limits or any warning signs. Despite that, however, the EPD will also be monitoring the situation. Also, we are aware that in the anonymous letter, reference was made to certain custom declaration documents. We've, you know, been in touch with the C&E department. They told us that they will carry out the necessary follow-up actions. If they discover that any such declaration documents, the content of which are problematic, they will follow up. I already mentioned this earlier. Some members suspected whether or not some of the sand materials have been stolen. You said the sand had been stolen. So it's a theft, right? Some members has that suspicion. I believe the law enforcement authorities, if they have reasonable reasons to doubt, they will certainly follow up on that. Although this is only an anonymous letter, but the allegations made in this letter, if they have to do with the law enforcement department's concern, they will certainly follow up. And our coordination office will maintain a close liaison with those departments. Chairman, I just want them to give us a report. They say the EPD will monitor the situation, the AA will do that as well. I want them to give us a report. Especially during this period of time, they told us that they have conducted tests or monitoring. Mr. Leung, you want the Bureau to provide evidence that they've not done it. Normally, the evidence should be provided. The onus of the proof should come from the person making the allegation. Now, in your speech, you asked the Bureau to clarify. They say they have not. So I think the person making the allegation should come up with the evidence. I'm not going to debate with you over this point. I'm being confused as well, Mr. Leung. I just want them to answer my question. That is whether or not they can provide us with the monitoring reports of the EPD during this period, as well as the report from the AA to see whether there's any discrepancies. Chairman, the EPD's monitoring of the water quality, such information is put on to their website. It's not only, well, of course we can still provide the information. The public can also, you know, access such information about water quality on their website. Well, I think as an electrical member, I don't think it should be for me to go online to access the information. I'm talking about what the EPD has done during this period of time. Why don't you go online and download the information? Ms. Leung Kwok Hong, followed by Mr. Yu Chung Yim. If we can solve all the problems going to the website, we don't need to convene a meeting. Why don't we have a video conference, you know, online? I'll give you a simple example. You say you have conducted 800 tests. What are the results of those tests? We would like to know. No matter how you pray, you want God to listen. Now, the question I want to ask is, when did you start dumping sand into the sea? You poured sand into the sea. When did you begin to do that?
Sand going into the sea was in the middle of November.
Okay.
Last November, right? You say that you've been checking the sand all along, you've taken samples. When did you discover that the material is actually, rock dust?
We knew all along. We've always planned for using quarry sand as well as marine sands.
Yes,
have you discovered that rock dust has been poured into the sea among all the tests and samples that you've tested? So, when the materials arrived, you didn't find out that they were rock dust, right?
But before the material was delivered to site, we checked the sources. We already knew and had planned it years ago that the materials could be, as long as they meet our grading, they could be rock dust, they could be marine sand from whatever source. So it's not a surprise that rock dust came. It's a rock sand that was used, and it complies with the grading for our requirement. So it meets the sand requirement with less than 10% fines.
Okay.
So you are saying that whatever type of sand they are, you'll find them acceptable, or would you check the materials according to the quotation and the specifications listed there?
The contractor proposes the various sources. There are many contracts here. There's more than just one. The initial sand being placed in the 11th of November was by the DCM contractors, not the contractor mentioned in this letter, although he has subsequently placed sand. They proposed the sources of those sand. They proposed using sand from quarries, predominantly, in fact, almost exclusively in the mainland. There are some other sources they proposed. We checked those sources for compliance. We also took tests to make sure that those comply with our specification. And then as the materials were delivered, we checked each delivery and carried out a test. All of those tests confirm that the materials comply with our specification.
Understood. What you're saying is that you've checked the materials, or have you not? you keep saying that you don't care so long as the sand which is dumped into the sea doesn't cause pollution. Is that your answer?
So, as I said before, and in fact I've said several times, we care very much where the material comes from and that it complies with our specification. That is just one element of how we minimize the water quality impact, by making sure that the fines content and the sand complies generally with our specification, and the fines content is below 10%. As we've explained, there are other measures in terms of how we place the material. It's not just dropped into the water, it's placed carefully in the material. There are existence of silk curtains to stop any expansion of that, of those, any plumes beyond this area of the site, and we monitor continuously the water quality.
Let me put it directly to you. You know that the materials are cheaper. Are you aware of that? If they were procured at a cheaper price, you still accept that? Are you saying that, this is really, so if the sand has been stolen, you're actually taking delivery of stolen goods? What happened if somebody were to want to take back the sand as evidence and want you to take it up again and use as evidence? What are you going to do? You must convince us. You must satisfy our requirement. We are paying for the sand. Why don't the government answer the question instead? Well, this is totally unacceptable. If the sand had been stolen, they are cheaper. That is already, because of that, it's already a crime. Well, Mr. Leung, this is unsubstantiated. I'm putting it to him. If that's really the case, would they have to be responsible? All five of them, except the one in the far right. Do you have a responsibility in that scenario? If that should have happened, do you have a responsibility?
Chairman, when I answered the other, Mr. Leung already said that if law enforcement agencies suspect that there is theft, but you are the owner. The administration and the AA are the owners of the project. If you should find, well, what are you doing? Just like MTR stoppage yesterday. And I would ask you if someone should report that that was a mistake of the MTR, you just say you would fine it a few million dollars. So my question for you is, if this is true, what kind of responsibility falls on you? You can say, Mr. Leung, you are stupid, this is a hypothetical question. But then I'm telling you, you may be held liable. My question is very clear. We have asked so many questions. And the gentleman sitting behind is saying that he doesn't care as long as the water quality is not affected. So where does the money go? Where has the money gone? And if rock dust can take the place of marine sand, why don't you just go for rock dust? Why do we have to spend so much? You should watch your accounts. Don't think that we are stupid. Don't brush aside our questions. $1.5 billion. You have circumvented the Legislative Council and we could do nothing about it. Now, don't give us such answers. Say, if the lamp doesn't work, if it is substandard, our Electrical Commission will do something. Your time is up. Your time has been exceeded. Next member, Professor Edward Yao, and then Mr. Jeremy Tam. Thank you, Chairman. Today we don't have any engineering people at the meeting, and this may not be fair to the attendees because they may not know the specific details. They say all the tests have shown compliance, but that is not a fact. Just look at your own website. The November report, SS suspended solids. There were 23 incidents of exceedance at your monitoring stations. And then in December, this is in January, 16 times, February, 13 times. Of course, there is explanation given as well, saying that there may be impact from the environment. But these analysis should be done by engineering people. So there have been exceedances, and today we like the AA or the government, well, as the Undersecretary said, you would have done follow-up action. And I'm talking about November to February, where there have been incidences of exceedance. What have you done by way of follow-up action in these 4 months? And then you should have the information for March as well. The allegation is that perhaps there have been serious incidents in March. I'd like you to provide SS data for March. There have been like dozens, a dozen or dozens of SS exceedance. I'd like to ask about March to see whether the situation has become serious. And in fact, every SS test should have an independent lab report. I'd like to see those lab reports so we understand the actual causes and the actual situation about every SS incident. So that will be more convincing and objective. My last question is, the AA and the EPD, have these four steps to tackle or process complaints. I'd like to know whether this incident has entered into the second stage of your complaint handling process. Who will take the questions? The AA, please. Mr. Lee. Chairman, it is correct. If you go online, you can see our monthly environment monitoring report. All the data have been uploaded, including suspended solids incidents. This is one of our major parameters because this and the water quality can actually tell us whether the reclamation project is making an impact on the environment in the vicinity. And every time when we do monitoring, we would use some indicators. If a certain indicator is exceeded, we would do investigation. Mr. Yu mentioned the SS incidents, and every time when there was an exceedance, the ET and the IEC would analyze the situation. What would they analyze? They would look at the water current situation during the time of exceedance and what kind of projects are being undertaken in the vicinity. As you know, Hong Kong waters to the west and to the east are very different. And to the west, there will be more concentration of SS and there would be more turbidity. And as I said, we would also have monitoring points at the upstream. And we would go upstream to look at the actual concentration, and then we would compare that with the monitoring points around the work site. If at upstream the concentration rate is more or less the same near the works area, then we know where the source is. But in any situation, if there is any exceedance at all, if after the analysis we will confirm that it is not directly related to our works, the ET would still remind our contractors to continue or step up mitigation measures to check again whether everything is in order. Well, that is why we like to have the information for March. We are talking about March today. You say everything is all right, but we don't have the report yet. Well, let me explain the timing. By the end of March, some of the parameters, especially the one with heavy metal, we need to wait for the lab report for a week and then we can do the analysis. So usually we need to wait till the middle of the next month. Well, no, the SS report can be available within a few days. Yes, that's correct. But even if the report is not ready, we are transparent. We can upload it on the website. We have received the report for March, and there is not a big difference between March and February. That's what I can tell you. This Mr. Jeremy Tam, to be followed by Mr. Holden Chow. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to ask a few questions, please, about this whistleblowing letter. I have heard from the AA that some investigation has been done. Can I confirm with you that you have already finished your investigation into this anonymous letter's complaints? Who will take the question?
Investigating the specific allegations, yes, I think we are largely
concluded.
Okay, then I'd like to have your investigation report. Please submit it to the subcommittee, please. Can you give the investigation report to us?
We can certainly give a summary of our responses to each of the
my summary. What do you say?
No, not a summary. I want the report, because we have spent over an hour at this meeting just to talk about this. And the AA has already done comprehensive investigation. If you have done that, why can't you give the report to us?
We don't actually have a report. We've done the investigation, as we heard. We got the letter at the end of last week. We've been looking at all of the allegations. So we've investigated each aspect of it. We don't have a report written up.
If that's the case, then with regard to every allegation in this complaint letter, and I'm most concerned about the last part, and that is whether another vessel has been used and whether there has been theft of sand. Because if indeed there is theft, in fact, it is very easy for you to check. Say, on a certain day, a barge comes into Hong Kong. There are many contractors, but you can check which one. And then you can ask the contractor to prove the source of the material. You can always check, right? And if no evidence can be supplied, as the Undersecretary said, then perhaps that may be a problem. And then you would have the responsibility to tell the law enforcement agencies your suspicion. Can you do that? Because, as I said, if you would do the checking and investigation, would you forward information to law enforcement agencies? Who would take the question?
I can think where we investigate, if we find no evidence, it's difficult to then, I don't know what we do if there's no evidence. We can't pass on no evidence.
So it's my understanding that when sand was delivered to Hong Kong, you were able to confirm that the source of sand was legal, that the sand was taken to Hong Kong through a legal channel. Have you confirmed that?
It's not a specific test we do on each barge. As we've said, the quarried sand doesn't require an import license to come into Hong Kong.
I'd like to go back to your PowerPoint. I'd like to talk about dolphins. You said that to the south, you would see how dolphins would go south. I'd like to ask whether you have actual data to show how many dolphins have gone south. This is the first question. Number two, you say that if you should see a dolphin within a certain distance, all works would stop for 30 minutes. How many times have that happened, that you actually had to stop works? Who will take the questions? Mr. Lee? About CWD monitoring. We have to do two marine surveys every month, meaning that we will follow the routes to look at Lantau north, southwest, and south and northwest. And if you look at the last month, the statistical figure or abundance, which is also used by AFCD, the number should be 60 dolphins. And this is in line with the AFCD sightings. Of course, to the north of Lantau, there is a decrease, but to the west and southwest, there has been more. Second question about monitoring of dolphins. There was once, at the beginning of the works, when a dolphin came into the 200-meter dolphin exclusion zone, and the works stopped, and after the dolphin had left for 30 minutes, works resumed. Thank you. When was that, please? In which month? It should have been December or January, but I need to confirm the date with you. Okay, thank you. Mr. Holden Chow? To be followed by Mr. Michael Luke. Thank you, Chairman. About this whistleblowing letter, which is anonymous, I think we have spent the entire meeting on it. I have been following the discussion closely, and I think the AA has responded to most of the allegations, like a rejection of deliveries, etc. You have said categorically that that did not happen. Now, I think the most effective way to deal with this is to let us know the two dates in March and the test results for those 2 days. Can you give us written information about those 2 days and the test done on those 2 days in March so that we know you have followed the procedures and you have done your part and you have seen no non-compliance? I hope you can do that so you can reply to queries. Secondly, according to this complaint letter, the Gold Mountain Marine Engineering Company, well, I Googled it just now on my phone. I cannot do any company search, but in fact, there are many companies with the same name, and they are all Hong Kong companies. I don't know. They are the same company, but anyway, I see a number of companies with the name Camfeng in Chinese. If it is a Hong Kong company, and if the allegations are so serious, including deception, theft, and even smuggling, illegal dumping, all these together are very serious accusations indeed. I would find this strange because this is a letter dated the 25th of March and is almost a month now. If it is so serious, why did no one report to the police? I don't know whether someone reported to the police. I wouldn't know, but I haven't seen that happen. And this is so serious. I believe the whistleblower should report this to the police. And for me, I would say that normally these are anonymous complaints, and you can say that this is hearsay evidence. It may be admissible for civil cases, but not much weight would be accorded to it by the judge. You cannot locate the whistleblower, and the letter just came by like that. So the best way to deal with this, I think, is for the AA to give us the relevant test reports for March and what you did to test the fill material, and then you can allay the worries of members. Let's see whether that can be done.
Okay.
I think the answer is yes, they can do that. I think that's the best way to allay the public's concern. Mr. Lu Chung-Hong, thank you. We support the, those of us which support the TRS care a lot about the environment and the impact on the ecology. Many of us are concerned about the questions relating to the marine sand. I understand that in the mainland, they have very restrictions regarding the export of marine sand. The standards have now made a lot more stringent. I won't comment on the on whether or not the allegation is true or not. You said that you've investigated and you found that it's not substantiated. But in future, such a same incident may happen again. That is the source of the sand. I mean, for some reasons, they cannot export the sand required. Will you have other alternative source of supply so that you get the materials you need for reclamation? We need to know, otherwise, you may have another incident during which, you know, someone cannot, you know, find the materials as promised and they give you something else. According to a study by the Hong Kong University, the CWD, which in Hong Kong, not the 60 odd, you know, as suggested by the AFCD, but there are more than 300, but they do not always, you know, stay in Hong Kong, that they would be, you know, in and out of territory. We have quite a large, substantial number of CWDs in Hong Kong. So would the Bureau and other departments consider working with expert groups to conduct a survey on the Chinese white dolphins? If you say the dolphins are now have now moved to the southern part of Lantau, of course it would even happen to humans. If it's noisy, you would get moved somewhere else. Now, if it's in the for the waters in the vicinity, have you you know, implemented any measures to better protect the habitat for the dolphins? Two questions.
Thank you for your concern. You're right. There is a concern, obviously, about supply of sand. That's why we have allowed different types of materials, including quarried sand as well as marine sands. The contractor has indicated a number of sources that he will be using for that, in fact, both overseas and also mainland sources. So we've got every confidence he will be able to provide that sand as required.
Okay.
Regarding the question of the dolphins, of course, we are aware of the report by the Hong Kong University. If I may explain that, the AFCD normally will use the term abundance. They mentioned the figure of 66. At the same time, they're talking about the number of dolphins appearing in the waters of Hong Kong at the same time. The Hong Kong U adopted a different statistical method. The number they quote is 300 odd. What they mean is that these are the dolphins which are in the waters of Hong Kong for most of the time. But there's no contradiction here. The Hong Kong U would also not only look at the waters of Hong Kong, they will also, you know, cover the territories in the estuary of the Pearl River. So we do conduct support studies about the dolphins. Of the applications we have received from the fund, we would also be looking at how we can support the studies, you know, proposed by these applicants. You say the dolphins have moved to the southern waters of Lantau. Have you done anything to take care of the habitat of the dolphins in that part of our waters? For we're talking about the western and southwestern part of Lantau. These are waters where we don't have any development, and they're relatively more welcome by the dolphins. All along, there's less, you know, influenced by human development. In our conservation proposals, we would propose measures. For example, whether we're going to build artificial reefs and so on, that we can, you know, improve the habitat for the dolphins. All members already finished with the question for the first round, Mr. Jiu. You have a second round. We've also received a motion proposed by Mr. Jiu. And we need to adjourn at 10:30. Should we first deal with your motion first? Is your second question also related to this motion? Chairman, may I propose that we deal with a motion, and if there's still time yet, we can go for the second round of questions. Mr. Edici has now moved the motion. I think we need to copy this to members first. Before we do that, I'd like to go to our next agenda item first. Item 3 on the agenda is AOB. To assist members to understand the latest development of the TRS project and the Marine Traffic Management Scheme, the authorities has arranged for a site visit for members of the committee on the 5th of May to the Hong Kong International Airport. So if members are interested, please enroll now. Also, the date of our next meeting is scheduled for the 12th of June, a Monday, at 2:30. The agenda items will be the enhancement plan for the Hong Kong International Airport and the air traffic control for the 3RS project. I'm sure Mr. Tam will be able to provide us with lots of information on the subject. All right, we will now deal with the motion moved by Mr. Eddie G. We can do that once the comments are available.
Mr. Tam.
While we are waiting for the copies of the motion, since Mr. G, so can I be allowed to speak first? Chairman, regarding the price of marine sand, I understand that the authorities told us that no, I'd like to clarify that the contract stipulates that you cannot divulge the price of the marine sand. For CLP and other organizations, they have shown us the cost of the fuel. We, on our part, will sign a confidentiality agreement. These two public utility companies are willing to show us the price of the fuels they procure. I think the A can do the same. We sign a confidentiality agreement, and then we will be shown the confidential information. Well, that is my suggestion. Will the AA consider providing us with the information regarding the price of marine sand on that basis? Mr. Chu, can you read out your motion? Given that the procurement of the fuel materials for the CRS, given that quality has an impact on the environment, the company requires the AA to provide details regarding the price, the quantity of the marine sand, and including the budget price and also the price per ton. Stipulated in the invoice, and also the name of the supplier, and also the source of the marine sand. We've asked the Bureau and the AA to provide such information. Mr. Ju has now formally make this request in writing. Mr. Lok, can I ask the AA this question? I understand that in Mr. Ju's motion, one of the points has to do with the price of the marine sand. And the AA said that they have not used any artificial sand. No, they've never denied that they've never used artificial sand. No, perhaps you were late. Yeah, they've already admitted that they've used it. Mr. Liu. Chairman, well, this morning we have allowed the administration and the AA to respond to the allegations in the anonymous letter, questions relating to the the fuel materials. Since the contract, and the price of the materials are involved. And I don't know what Mr. G is asking for the contracts of all the specific contractors, and also he's demanding information about the contract price. I don't know whether we should divulge that. Well, this is only a motion moved by Mr. Eddie G. As to how the Bureau would respond, it's their decision. Mr. G is not. Well, we want an answer, whether or not the Bureau will give us an answer, or whether they would adopt the approach as proposed by Mr. Jeremy Tam. That would be for them to decide. So, do we need to vote on a motion? Show of hands. So all those in favor, Mr. G has already read out the motion. So if you are in favor, please put up your hands.
Okay.
Right. Those against? Abstention. Eight in favor, no objection, and four abstentions. So the motion will be put on record and forwarded to the Bureau accordingly. With that, we may now adjourn our meeting. Mr. Leung. So what is the response to the motion? They will give us a written response, okay? Thank you.
好，唔該你哋啫。